For us at the DEA, we've come to showcase what we've been doing over the time since we got hired by this dynamic president of ours. I'd like to introduce to you the folks that are actually doing the work. I'm just the arrowhead who's still guiding the process. And so I take this opportunity and the privilege to introduce my deputy for administration, Attorney Bob Cole.
Please stand.
Right here. I'm sure I'm going to be here. Attorney Bob Cole is the deputy for administration. He's in charge of all of our administrative work. We've added additional assignment to him to review all of our cases, to take a quick look at some of the cases that are on the court, so as to strengthen our legal department. So he has double sole responsibility. Now, my man, my buddy is Mr. Hassan Fediga. That's the big guy here. He is responsible for operation. You know, I'm not strong to operation, so I love my operation people. So Fediga is the guy who is very present, who has a range of estimates and understanding of the field as he speaks. He's responsible now to do a lot of work. After our budget, going through all the processes, Fediga will be traveling out of here to go to the States, to go to a couple of other countries around our neighborhood. So he's got a lot of busy work to do. So we like to have the opportunity to do these folks. These are the guys we call the DEA. Like I said, as you know, my name is Colonel A.B. Cromer. I'm the figurehead and the arrowhead. So it is again a pleasure to introduce my people to you. These are the guys that got me busy, and I got them busy more than anything else. I got Fediga running up and down the ghetto, and I'm begging the other people, man, to put out some of these gloves, because to go to General Building and go to Zimbabwe, it's not a fun issue. So he said, well, do you? I said, no. And I saw him dividing food in the ghetto. So that's the extent of this, that's the enormity of the task we had about the year. So we can't wait to get our new offices so we can just move on that cluster and we can have more time to do what we do best. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I have the enviable task today to address this podium. The Monday's podium for all that is happening at the LDEA. Good morning, member of the press. You are esteemed member of the press and fellow citizen in Rutherland and in the TV land. We gather here to address a matter of utmost importance to the well-being and the future of our nation. The alarming rise of narcotic substance abuse among Liberian youth. Recent reports have shed light on concerning trends, indicating that a significant number of our young people are involved in the misuse of experimentation of illicit drugs. This issue demands our immediate attention and collective action for which we have been called here today to address. Statistics and projections. I will drill you through the projection, through the statistic, so that we have a view as to where we are in our fight against illicit drugs and abuse. According to a report by the United Nations Population Fund, approximately 20% of the Liberian youth, equivalent to an estimated 1.1 million. Individuals are currently affected by the narcotic substance abuse. These figures are deeply troubling and underscore the urgent need for intervention. And I can assure you the budget that we sent to the budget that we crafted, basically represent the enormity of this problem. And contrary to the views out there, we will take you the intervention, the procedure, the catalog to you, the steps that we've taken to address the issue of drugs, and the recommendations that we will offer for the people out in the House of Representatives and Senate, and our own executive branch of government. More of our projections suggest that if left unchecked, the number of young and youth in our community entangled in drug abuse could rise to approximately 1.237 million. Within the next 6 years, just in 6 years' time, we'll take from 1.1 to 1.2 million by young people on drugs. This projection emphasizes the gravity of the situation and highlights the critical importance of implementing effective measures without delay. Then I'll take you to the commitment of the Liberian Drug Association. What is it we have undertaken? What we soon to, what we decided to address as an agency. In response to this pressing issue, the Liberian Drug Enforcement Agency, LDA, reaffirmed its unwavering commitment to combating drug trafficking in substance abuse within our borders. We understand the significance of this matter and are dedicated to undertaking honest effort to reverse and reduce the prevalence of drug abuse among Liberian youth. You guys sit out here and make commitment to me, particularly, and to this government and to this president, that abuse and consider drug abuse and the effect they have on our society and our children as the utmost importance of this presidency. The recent operation that actually we got to achieving this objective. Over the past week and months, the LDA have conducted numerous raids, the law enforcement operation across the rural county. Now, first, I'll take you to the steps that we've undertaken in addressing the issue of drug addiction in our country. Now, we did a feasibility study as to where we are, where are we going to concentrate regarding the influx of drugs. First, we will get into reducing, but we have to now look at the traffickers, those that are bringing the drugs there. Before we start to enforce it, we wanted to take our time to first address the issue of trafficking. You guys are bringing across our borders, you guys are distributing it in our borders to start to go after them. Now, with those tactics and understanding, we decided to first address the aspect. And so we targeted people and places that are prevalent in the distribution process. So the western part of Nigeria became our target. We started to go after traffickers. We could not go, unfortunately, we could not go across the border to places that have been earmarked to be the route and the place of concentration. We basically took the Sierra Leone part of our border, we took the Guinean border to actually address some of the issues with regards to coach that became the drug of choice for most of our young people. And then we took this Tramadol as a place, as a source to that has become prevalent among our young people. So our progress now basically was centered around those particular issues. And then we start to spread the little intelligence, the little means we had to go after guys who are distributing them. And because we didn't have any money, we didn't need any money in the budget, we decided to do things that were not monetized. We did not have cash to do it, so we started to do the resilience and the tenacity of the folks that we have at the judicial level. I call Federica Attorney and I say, look, but we have to make progress. We have to now look at those areas that we couldn't get funding. Right now, we start to do a little bit of church and bar, bus and bar. We started to do personal intel. And people started to come to us from society. So look, we know what the drug dealers do. We know who's responsible for Muslim, who's responsible for Bushwagon. We took those intelligence, we start to work on them, and gradually we start to get footing to get them there to use the Muslim drugs. So we took a three-front approach, reducing the supply to the market and dealing with the guys who are distributing there around here. After that, we also decided to go to the rehabilitation aspect. But to rehabilitate, you need a place to kill the folks so they can have the opportunity to actually go after the folks that are affected. We have two clients in this process. We have the judicial client and we have the rehabilitation client. Now, the judicial client are guys that we have to take to court, prosecute under the new drug law. And the judicial and the rehabilitation client are guys who we have to take to rehabilitation. Now, don't forget, we're also members of the President Task Force. We have to list for the Task Force to start to work towards achieving the objectives set by the Task Force. As we went along the process, we started to make our progress based upon that. And at the end of the day, we're beginning to look at folks that have volunteered to help with this process. And that volunteerism basically yield a lot of results for us. We arrested a lot of folks, and the folks that we already have now in court going through the process of the adjudication. And unfortunately for us, we could not go to the rehabilitation part. So if people say what the DAs have done, everything we catalog here has been placed within our budget, so that we can address it and we can share with the press. The budget is line items that we place in our budget that you can draw a line through and see exactly what are those lines are within the confines of what we said we are doing. And then when we're doing it, we can also ask you to come and check us. Go ahead and see the progress that we're making. Today, I can report to you that the coach, the drug of choice that went to the slum community. Before we talk about it, it used to be $100 per round. Today, guess what? Because of the enforcement tactics we've adopted, it has gone to $200. So for us, that's the barometer. That's the yardstick on which we can say, yes, indeed, we are turning the curve of deterrence. We're now putting up scarcity of the drug on the Liberian market to a large extent. And I can show you what these guys are about. The drug epidemic is a war that can be won by the Liberian government. Now, to win this war, we must have the participation, the involvement of both the House and the Senate to actually win this war. What we've also done, we started to reach outside of the border. We got call from the new DEA director in Sierra Leone, the general, called upon us to have a conversation as to how we can make progress towards achieving some objectives for us. We made contact with him. He has agreed to actually work with us so as to achieve certain objectives. He shared ideas. We shared our ideas with him. And he's going to be coming to our drug day in Liberia. I will make the first visit to Sierra Leone to assess whatever they're doing, give them the intel, the information we have, so they can know exactly what we're doing on this side of the border. Because Kush taking over Sierra Leone, to a large extent. And because of that, they've appointed a general. By the way, we still a general anyway. Yeah, with the general. But he is a general in the Sierra Leone Army. And then he really wanted to tap into the strategy that we used to actually get in front of him without even the requisite funding. So I've been making that trip there along with one of my deputies to the Republic of Sierra Leone. So we conduct a specific and special operations, which is something that the general took some interest in. We notably a special operation led by a special agent Clarence Clark in the Singleton community resulted in the apprehension of several suspected drug dealers, including George Obi, a Nigerian national who claimed to be a Liberian national, with the brother known for his alleged involvement in drug trafficking within my people. He actually is the guy who credited the whole of Bushra Island to. And preparing since his capture and the vigorous step towards this thing, we try to push the gap considerably, but we intend to push forward after we have the budgetary allotment we have, just to start to get some bad money, just to be more intelligent, both inside Liberia and outside Liberia, just then that will allow us to actually do a lot. And I imagine we are doing this much progress. That we have the requisite thing, requisite money. We also need an intelligence in Ghana, where most of the boat ride for drugs, hard drugs actually coming out of Ghana on the Hudson. We will be targeting, and that's what we'll be forced the Maryland Department to be on the alert for it. Basically, substantial narcotic substance was seized from Mr. Obi's residence, which was displayed to most of the folks when he was arrested. Additional arrests of high-profile individuals such as non-cousin Peace Billy and Ivan Colon further demonstrate our commitment to holding accountable those involved in drug trafficking in our country. Enhance inspection and risk assessment. In our effort to strengthen border security and prevent the influx of illicit drugs, the LDA has conducted inspection of transportation vehicles at the border side. That has been one of the targeted areas we have in here. And the deputy director led the team in the border side area, and we basically successfully arrested a lot of drugs from the transportation that we got through there. A lot of them, and we have those in our storage here. And we followed some of the folks, to the court, and the court basically, once they go to the circle court, we transfer all the drugs in the morning to the circle court. But we didn't want to, somebody, like I was in court yesterday, a preliminary hearing of the OB case, and one of the challenge that those guys put up is the defendant, different lawyers said, that the drugs and the money were not in the better way of the court. I said, so I asked the guy, what is better way mean? They are not lawyers, but I mean, just to get a further understanding, so basically what we need to confirm the court, which basically was not true, because we followed every drug within the court. There's a policy we said, once you go to the separate court, we want to serve the trust the court. What is the judge that is at the drug court? I have explicit confidence in him. So we send the money, the drug, everything there to everyone in the you. And basically, so we took them out there and he's been happy. And now, individual arrested within these cases, just a little detail as to who we arrested. Recent arrests, including that of the suspect Opa Kawi and the suspect Marvin Morris, underscore the effectiveness of our enforcement effort. So the COVID cases particularly serve as an example of our vigilance in detecting and spearheading individuals into drug trafficking men. So basically, that's the level of that is at the tail end of what we do. But what of what we've done, we've segmented the country. We will now put up a situation where Liberia become a big hub for the force. So we divide ourselves. Basically, we start to address this thing on a regular basis as we went ahead with looking at the drug trafficker. And from looking at them, then we start to move over for their operation, taking them out again. And I can report to you again that we've gone a little bit ahead of them to some extent. with the budgetary argument now, if the budget actually asks for it, if that is provided for us, we can allow the press to be our witness, to be the people looking at what we've done, so as to make sure that everything we ask for this government will be accountable, will be represented in everything we do, basically. So, in conclusion, the Liberian Drug Enforcement Agency will remain steadfast in its mission to combat drug trafficking and substance abuse in Liberia. We urge the public to join us in the fight by reporting any suspicious activity and supporting our effort to safeguard the well-being and future of our young people. Now, that's for the drug aspect. I want to drag you to the 100 day. The 100 day basically will give you a window shot as to what the DEA is doing, what the DEA intend to do as far as beyond this particular 100 day period. First, we said we're going to do community engagement. Because coming into this process, you have to engage the community. You have to get to the community, let the community to know exactly what are you doing with regards to the drug act. Because every aspect of society is involved in it. So we took the chance and start to empower the community people who schedule and conduct town hall meetings in rural communities across Europe. Educate communities, members about the danger of drugs use and an importance of understanding the forfeiture law. I have gone to the church. I went to the Methodist church, the first Methodist church. I've gone to the masjid. I went to Galashu Mosque. I've gone to the Lipochu Mosque. I'm also on my way this Sunday. I'm going to the Baptist church on Ivan Street. And from there, I've asked all the guys out there in the rural part of the country to go to do the community engagement, but also use the religion-based institution to try to widen our spread of this message. Because everybody want to go to church. You don't go to church, you go to the mosque. One of them. Those that can go to church or mosque will meet them in the community. So we want to make sure we gather everybody together and then address the issue. And then communicate to the folks. The forfeiture law is very important. Let the folks know that if you are caught and prosecuted, you will have to face the full weight of the law, but your property will be seized. And if you are on government land, that's the worst thing. We'll seize your property from you immediately once you are federal, basically. With the community engagement, the expected outcome will be to increase awareness. Community members will have a better understanding of the risks associated with drugs use and the legal consequences through education sessions, through town hall meetings. Community engagement. Today, we have people out there in the streets doing community engagement, meeting the community members, talking to them, and allowing them to ask questions about the prevention of drugs and rehabilitation, so as to know exactly how we're going to proceed in the fight against drugs. So when I hear people say that the DEA have not outlined these things alive, then I consider it an opinionated comment. Think beyond that. So, the strengthening relationship, building trust and collaboration between law enforcement agencies, the community, fostering partnership to combat drugs relationship. We foster a relationship with the LNP. The Liberian National Police is a traditional partner. We've spoken to them. Matter of fact, we are in the process of building some MOU with the police has to provide us the requisite assistance. So we ask the police, don't go out there and do any raiding thing. Don't take people off their little habitat they have. The reason why we have them in these Zimbabwe and all these places is because he went there. I feel bad for Fred sometimes. He went into Zimbabwe. I've gone to visit Zimbabwe or to Zimbabwe. To make it a constant raid area, to go there, we ask the police, give us a break. It is our statutory responsibility. We know why the guys are there, and because we don't have anywhere to put them right now. Because if we scatter them from there, they will go back in the community and will start to victimize folks in the community. Because they are sick people. They're not well. So if we got them from this area where they are contained, The police report will go through their arrest, men commit a crime, you steal somebody to get arrested, and, but if you take all the guys from there, they don't have anywhere to go, you'll be put in the community in jeopardy. And I will make that comment to them. But again, our collaboration with them is going to further those arrangements so that we move the process strategically and holistically, because we have to put these two together and look at it from a broader perspective. And empowering community. This is one of the, I'm giving these tactics so that you can know exactly what we've got 100 days until what we're moving forward to. It is that we do not just go ahead, take search warrant, go arrest people. That's not what we do. We also do arrangement, engagement, and these things, I think that coordinated by the operation department. Improve enforcement, enhance operation between the law enforcement, which are going to prevention and rehabilitation, identifying community's specific need and concern regarding drug enforcement, leading to the development of tailored prevention and rehabilitation program to address the issue of effectiveness. Now, this is what we've tried to do. We, because government is not prepared for the structure of a government-run rehabilitation center, which is being constructed in Lentor, we have gone to do this private partnership. Private partnership is giving us an opportunity to get private initiated. Guys like Senator Dillon has a private initiative. We partner with them. I mean, his school is a little. But we still partner with him. There are folks in the Grand Basel Highway, we partner with them. Folks in Maryland, we partner with them. And Senator Ballou also has an initiative with partnering with him so as to move this process forward. So basically, it is something that falls also within our community outreach. Implementing awareness campaign. Today, we have people on the street going to the rural community besides what we've done in the church and the mosque and other places. I'm also going to the BW Harris School. We're going to the institution. We're going to the government-run institution by this week. We start to go to the Dartmouth and other places where folks are. The University of Liberia will be visiting as well. So as to make sure that these things are done properly so that people know exactly the danger of the prevention, what it takes to actually work ahead of this process. And going to the rural communities. Today I have about 4 members of the community in my house. And I can report to you today, when I got them from the street, they came into my yard at the displeasure of my family, of course, but I saw that leaving them like that, in a week or two, they will be inundated for more drugs. So I brought them in there, and the time they spent there tried to drone out. For a few days they spent there, I found out that the drug had left their body. Today they are recuperating, and I can see life in their faces. That made me proud this morning when I woke up. I saw the kids, they all came to me, gave them some food and stuff like that. So that's what we all need to start to do, help a neighbor. Mine is different because I have an enclosed fence, so we can't go out to find drugs at this point in time. And this should be the information material. We're doing that right now. We will be. The content meet, you will see in the content meet, you see the DLDA sign will be giving leaflet out to folks so as to reach out to the folks about what is necessary to help them with the information on these issues as well. Behavior change, greater awareness and education may lead to positive behavior change for our people. I've observed it today personally myself. I saw exactly what went on to do that, to the behavior change with that. Empowerment, partnership development, which we've done, expected outcome. Enhanced collaboration by fostering partnership with local community leader, religious institution, the NGO. There will be improved coordination and collaboration in drug prevention and rehabilitation efforts, which is something we intend to do. Now, increase resources. Leveraging the resources of partner organizations, community leaders will result in greater access to funding. That's what we intend to do. We will use this podium and use your medium just to get out to the folks out there in the community, our partners there, that we are in dire need of their support, our government in that, to fight this war, to defeat this war. We need the participation of our partners. We need the little handout, whatever they can do. We don't need you to give us cash. Look at some of the projects we've promulgated, projects we've sent out there, when you look at it, and see if we can take up the initiative. So after we've already developed a strategic framework, that strategic framework will be sent to the partners. The partner will come and validate those partners. After the meeting by next week, we'll start to do that. Now, something else we're doing in the LDA that has not been done, we are developing a strategy, we're developing a framework where you can be in Pinestown. You know, I left Pinestown because I spent some time in Pinestown when I was a young guy in school. Pinestown, you can be as far as Pinestown or Zletown. Some of the favorite cities, Zletown or Pinestown, you can stay there when there's a drug arrested there. The guy in there will just key in the key, the drug, the case number, and the case number will be sent out to the structure we just set up. We leave from Pinestown, we go to the county commander to the regional commander, straight to Moruga to the guy. One case to just there. So everybody being phoned right in that line up to my office. Go to the director for operation, then forward to my office, then I see it live. And then we also have to report to the president office, have to report to the minister of justice and our partner, the UNODC. So that's the structure we've just established at this point as we go. So it's something that is revolutionary, that we have the opinion that it will help in our fight against this process. So at this point in time, the LDA will only be particular as to how we can be, how we can develop more diverse perspective. Partnering with a variety of organizations and community leaders to bring that fresh perspective. We asking that people come in. When the validation process of our strategic framework is done, we'll ask for people to come in with their views, how we can move it. In that stakeholder meeting we have, the Zogos will be represented, what you call the Zogos will be represented there, I'm sorry to say that. They will be represented, and the members of the community, the press, the police, the immigration, our partner in the LRA, they all will be present there, so as to perfect views that will help to strengthen or reduce or provide additional information on how we can move the drug issue forward. So it's not something reduced to us alone, basically. So basically, we don't want to take up much of these times anymore. That is the DA initiative we have. We will be open. We are moving from the acquired the dump site holding office. We have gotten blessings to move ourselves. It was the GSA now. We'll be moving to our new office, and you guys will be invited to come and see exactly what is the new home of the DEA. At this point in time, I'd like to express our heartfelt appreciation to the information family for affording us this grand stage to let the world and the Liberia people know that the DEA has got steps. We got first we identify, first we reduce the inflow of drugs, then the rehabilitation process. Then from the rehabilitation process, it goes down to the folks that will go through the TVS and the life skills situation. From that aspect, then the guys are prepared to get back on the street. And that's our effort, that's what we do. And I'd like to take the opportunity for you, for helping us and listening to us. Please spread, let the folks know that we are a force of good that come to help. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
From the Everett Comedy and the
first.